The Ferguson T20 tractor, or Little Grey Fergie, the machine that revolutionized farming. Gordon, John and Graham Charity used 6 T20s on their 300-acre farm in North Cambridgeshire. The last of these tractors was built nearly 40 years ago, but there are still thousands in use all over the country. The T20 was the culmination of a lifetime's work by its inventor, Harry Ferguson. He was born in 1884 on a small farm in the north of Ireland. Before the T20, most farming was done by horses and human labour, making the work extremely slow and arduous. By the outbreak of the First World War, there were over 1 million horses on farms in Britain. There were tractors available, like the Fordson, but they were large and unwieldy. Dragging rather than controlling the implements, they were only useful for ploughing large fields. On smaller farms, the horse remained the only option. Whilst working in the motor trade in Belfast, Ferguson set out to design a new kind of tractor. He could see that it was the lack of control over implements which held existing tractors back. He developed a linkage system which brought the two together as one machine for the first time. A prototype, the black tractor, went into production in England. But Ferguson fell out with the manufacturer and less than 2,000 were made. Eager to see his tractor mass-produced, he demonstrated it to Henry Ford in America in 1938. A deal was struck and Ford agreed to manufacture the tractor in the States, incorporating Ferguson's linkage system. The new tractor was called the Ford Ferguson.
And on June 29, 1939, at Dearborn, Michigan, the product of their collaboration was first made public.
American farmers were initially skeptical about the new tractor because of its small size. But once they saw what it could do, the Ford Ferguson sold in large numbers.
Mr. Ferguson, will this machine be a success for the small farmer?
Yes. It is deliberately planned to be a success on the small farm. We'll do all the work that animals do on the farm at less than half the cost.
But the small farmer in Britain would have to wait. Plans to export the tractor were halted by the outbreak of war. By the time the war ended, Ferguson had plans for a new, improved tractor to be made in Britain. He was encouraged by the new Labour government, who saw its potential for post-war reconstruction. A meeting was arranged between Ferguson and the Standard Motor Company, whose Banner Lane plant in Coventry was lying empty. They agreed to build the new Ferguson tractor. It was to be called the TE20. The first TE20s came off the production line in October 1946. At last, a light maneuverable tractor was available to British farmers. The combination of three-point linkage and hydraulics made tractor and implement one, and was sold to farmers as the Ferguson system.
If you think of a tractor as a mechanized horse, then of course you build a plough on wheels to harness to it. Now think of a tractor as a ploughing tool. Why not make the ploughshare part of it, without any wheels of its own, and couple it here, and here, and on top here. This three-point linkage, as it's called, is the crux of the idea. It makes every tool part of the tractor, not dead weight to be dragged. A lever at the driver's side operates a hydraulic pump to raise or lower the tool, so you can plough at any depth at a touch of the lever.
The impact of the new tractor was dramatic. Farmers were able to work faster and more efficiently. The TE20 could plough in an hour what had taken a horse the whole day. Because the tractor and its system were so revolutionary, Ferguson established a training school. Here, salesmen, engineers and farmers were taught the mechanics of this new way of working. The school was at Stoneleigh Abbey, a few miles from the factory.
Well, Stoneleigh was the hub of the organization. It used to travel to and fro in an old Daimler bus with fluid flywheel.
The main course, which takes 10 days, is divided between work in the field and in the classroom. It deals with both theory and practice. Many of the students are, of course, already familiar with the basic operations of tractor handling and driving. But others have to begin right at the beginning. They must be able, when necessary, to advise farmers on how to make the best use of tractor and implements, and how to get the full advantage of their flexibility.
A network of tractor dealerships sprang up all over the country. But it was through large public demonstrations that ordinary farmers first came into contact with the new tractor. The centerpiece of a demonstration was cultivating the small square. This was an area 20 feet by 27 feet, too small for a horse or any other tractor to work in.
We make sure that the driver is conversant with all the controls, and then he tries his hand at driving for the first time.
Ferguson service was extensive. When farmers bought a T20, the dealer came with it to make sure they knew what they were doing.
I'm one of the many thousands who farm the Ferguson way. It isn't just a case of being sold a tractor and then leaving it at that. It's the kind of service we get afterwards that's important to us, chap.
The T20 dominated the market. None of Ferguson's competitors had anything to match it. By 1951, the factory had reached peak production, building 325 tractors a day, 74,000 in that year alone. Ferguson had always intended that farmers all over the world should benefit from his system. By the mid-1950s, the T20 was being used in over 160 countries.
70% of the 74,000 tractors turned out by Ferguson's last year were exported. These tractors are now working at all sorts of jobs in many different countries.
As tractor sales grew, so did the sales of implements. Only Ferguson tools would fit the integrated system, and a whole new range of farm machinery had to be developed for the TE20.
Ploughing's only one job on the farm. An agricultural machine worth its petrol must do all the others too, better than a horse or a mechanical horse. A horse can't saw up logs. The tractor can, and dig post holes. There are 20 tools for 20 different jobs the tractor can do. Efficient mechanization has come to the farm.
A range of 60 different implements took the tractor to places it had never been before. Playing fields, building sites, road construction.
The roller is chain driven from the power unit's rear wheels and steered through an independent system. When the power unit is required elsewhere, it is a matter of minutes to disconnect.
In 1953, Harry Ferguson, by now nearly 70, sold out to the Canadian firm Massey Harris. Just 2 years later, production of the TE20 came to an end. In 10 years, over 500,000 tractors have been made, more than any other single British model before or since. The 1960s saw the end of the TE20 era. Farms were getting larger, so tractors did too. All over the country, farmers replaced their 26-horsepower Fergies with new tractors of up to 100 horsepower. The company is still at Banner Lane and has never ceased tractor production in nearly 50 years. The cheapest of the modern Massey Fergusons is now around £11,000. A single rear wheel costs more than the original T20. This legacy is acknowledged at the plant. The first T20 ever made dominates the entrance of the building as its inventor looks on. A plaque commemorates its achievement. The little Fergie hasn't completely disappeared. Most of the original $500,000 may have been scrapped, but thousands are hard at work all over the country. It still comes into its own on jobs where lightness and maneuverability matter.